Welcome to the Miami Dade Journals and Speakers Series. My name is Manolo Barco. I'm the advisor for the reporter, and I'll try not to phrase everything as a question. I've been told that I phrase everything as a question, so I'll try not to do that. Thank you for coming out to the event today, our first event for the Summer Journals and Speakers Series. Back in, I guess, 2007, when we first started here with the newspapers, wanted to make sure that students were able to get an opportunity to speak with journalists in their area, whether it's TV, print, or radio, and we wanted to make sure that was an opportunity. I remember being a student here at the college many, many years ago and getting to meet Leonard Pitts. I think my advisor, who was here at the time, David Mervis, is here today. And for me, it was a great moment to be able to meet someone that I kind of looked up to. So I wanted to make sure that it was something that we continue when I came aboard. So in that time, we've had 52 journalists visit Miami-Dade College. And then Monique is going to be number 53. But this year's series has a special place, I think, because this year's series, you know, Monique is starting it off. The five journalists that are going to be here are students that were part of the newspaper within the past 5 years, and now they are working in the industry. Lazaro Gamio, who works at the Washington Post. Alex DeArmas works at Channel 7. Melissa Dent works at Channel 6. Monique at the Herald, and Sergio Candido, who is at El Nuevo Herald. So I think this is a great opportunity for young people who are interested in journalism to see that, you know, Monique was in your shoes just 4 years ago. 5 years ago? 6 years ago, actually. Just 6 years ago here at the newspaper. So I think it's a good opportunity to kind of get some feedback and some advice from her as far as what she did when she was here. And maybe, obviously, you have a different path than she had. And everyone has their own path, but maybe you can kind of get some ideas, get some inspiration, and some, hopefully, inspiration for your future. So a little bit about Monique. I guess I first met Monique probably when she was 18 years old. She was still a high school student. She came over to the newsroom, was very enthusiastic about joining the newspaper. And, you know, she came over and she talked to us about, she had some experience at the Herald at the time, right? And I remember one of the first conversations that I had with her, and I told her, it doesn't really matter to me that you've written for the Herald. And I wasn't trying to be mean, I was just being pretty straightforward. I said, it doesn't really matter to me that you've written for the Herald and you've written stories there. I don't, because in my mind I didn't know whose edit it was and what exactly was her work. But I said, I need someone that's going to be able to listen and someone who's willing to work hard. And I can definitely say that Monique did that while she was here. Well, maybe the listening part wasn't so much, but... But that's a good thing for a journalist to have that trait, you know. I remember early on, we did the editor-in-chief. We have a committee that meets. It was between her and another young lady for the editor-in-chief position. And Monique, I think, like I said, she was still in high school. And she was going to prom, if I remember. So she came dressed. In the day that we had the actual committee meeting was the day of her prom. And we couldn't change the meeting date. And I had no idea anything about high schools and proms, and, you know, I'm far removed from that. So we went ahead and we did it. And she came in and she had this, like, she'll explain to you better what it was, but she had, like, this get-up and this outfit, and her hair was in a beehive-looking thing. And it was impressive. She came in and she still did it. And after that, she went over to the prom shortly after. And to me, that was an indication of start of, like, what Monique was. And she basically, whatever she had to do to get the job done, she did it. And that was true for the 2 years that she was here with the paper. I'll give you an example of a story. Monique had some issues with public safety. She had been writing a series of stories, I think some car break-ins that happened and cars that were stolen here on campus. And there was an official who was giving her a hard time. At this time, I think this was her second year, so she was probably like 19 years old. I think I'm right. It was like her second year, and she had gone over to pick up the public safety reports, and I guess she kind of had a back and forth with this person. The person was kind of rude, had been consistently rude with her throughout the past, and she ended up closing the door in her face. And I talked to her at some point, and said, "Hey, do you want me to intervene? Do you want me to talk to someone?" And I remember Monique telling me, and to me, I still think that at 19 years old, she had enough foresight to understand that it was the right thing to do. She told me, "I don't want you to do anything, I will handle this myself." And I asked her why. Like, she's clearly gone over what she's supposed to do. And she told me, because if you do something, then I won't be able to cover this beat anymore. And to me, that was pretty impressive that a 19-year-old would be able to comprehend that and think that all the way through. Like me, at that time, I was like 38, 36, somewhere in that range. I don't think I would have had the maturity to treat it so well. And I think that showed a lot as far as who she was. And she covered a lot of stories here that were hard-hitting and interesting stories that hopefully helped her develop to where she is. She covered, and she'll talk about it more, she covered an issue that was here with the basketball coach. She did a bunch of news stories that were pretty prominent at the time. But I made notes just in case. And people say, talk about, you know, the newspaper and what the newspaper means for student journalists. And for her, I know that the newspaper meant a lot. It was, like I was telling her the other day, it's like, I don't remember when Monique went to class. Like, she was in the newsroom all the time. Now, don't get me wrong, she did well. Whatever she didn't do when she was supposed to be in class, she took care of it. Because she had, and if I remember correctly, had all A's in all her classes except one B, right? It was a math class. English, surprisingly, English. But she did what she had to do, and I remember sitting at the Wilson campus. This was toward the end of her time here. It was a couple of weeks before graduation. And Monique was insistent on, I'm gonna stay here at Miami-Dade, I'm gonna stay at the Reporter, I'm gonna be here forever, I'm gonna be here for 4 years. That was her, and I told her she was crazy. She started doing research, she started looking at the criminal justice program, and I remember she went over to their department and got some information. I said, like, she's really serious about this, like, she's crazy. I knew she was crazy, but like now I really am, it's for sure. And I remember we were at Wilson, and I guess she got a phone call on her phone. She had to step away. You have like a different office, a glass enclosure office right next to mine. She walked over, and she gets out of there, and she's crying, like bawling. Like, if anybody knows Monique, that's not really any news. She cries and prays is what she does. But she was crying, and I was like, what's wrong? But I kind of knew right away what it was. And what happened is that she had gotten a call saying that she had won the Jack Kent Cook Scholarship. It's a $60,000 prize, which I think is more now, but at the time, a $60,000 prize to transfer. And I knew that what that meant was that she had to leave now. And to me, I mean, this kind of shows the commitment that she had for this paper, that she was so torn. And like at some point, she even joked around. Well, I think she was joking, but I'm not 100% sure that she was going to use her Jack Kent Cook grant and come here to a date. So, but that didn't happen. But I'll talk a little bit about what she's done, and I'll let her speak. Correct me if I do anything, if I say anything's wrong, but I think she's interned at the Boston Globe, at the New York Times. She's worked at the Boston Herald. She's worked at the Lowell Herald, and now she's covering several municipalities at the Herald. And she'll tell you about all the things she's done, but like I said, I'm going to show a video of her when she was here at the paper. This was probably in the summer after her freshman year, and talked a little bit about what her time was and just kind of get a sense of where she was at that time. So she ended up leaving here and went to Emerson College and graduated from there. She's been here, been back in Miami for about over, is it 2 years? 2 years now, covering Homestead, Palmetto Bay, and Coral, and Doral, and Doral, for the Herald. And she's been doing a series of stories. I mean, pretty much true to herself, when she came back to Miami, she started writing all kinds of crazy stories at the Herald about things that were happening. I think Shaq got sworn in as a police officer, right, somewhere. There was an alligator, was it a crocodile alligator that... Yeah, so she'll tell you a little bit of the crazy stories she's done, but in true form, you know, like I said, you know, one thing about her is that she's very curious, and she's, you know, kind of a pain in the butt. She's, you know, she's very good at going after people and being pestering in a nice way. You'll meet her, you'll talk to her, you know, she comes off like a sweet little girl, young lady, I should say. And we used to have a nickname for her. Like, everybody in the newsroom at the time had a nickname for a different animal. Sounds kind of weird, I know, but all of us had a nickname for like a different animal that we thought kind of represented our personalities, and hers was a bulldog. So I think it was appropriate at the time, basically. So, and Furman, I'm sure, can attest, you know, you were in Wilson when she was here. When she was here. So like I said, you know, David, glad to have David Mervis here. He's a professor who taught her when she was here. Like I said, he was also my advisor. And then, I mean, that's pretty much it. Hopefully the video will start soon, so I don't have to keep rambling on. We'll wait a couple more minutes. If it doesn't, then we'll just let mommy start talking. In the meantime, if any of you guys are interested in journalism and are students here and not enrolled or not do not have not started with the newspaper, you're more than welcome to speak to me or get up for a minute, Danielle. Daniela Molina, she's the editor-in-chief for the summer for the paper. So she's probably a lot friendlier than I am, so if you want to speak to her afterward, you can speak to her. Hopefully some of you guys will join the staff and be participating in that. All right, that's fine. We'll save Monique the embarrassment of showing that video. But like I said, we'll go ahead and let her start speaking. And Monique personified. There you go. I'm sorry.
Hi, my name is Monique. I'm the editor-in-chief of The Reporter. I cannot tell you how much I love this paper. You know, I have this box that I take pride in, because if you say something that really touches my heart, I'm gonna stop you and I'm gonna make you write it down. And this box is filled with all of those things. My passion for journalism is really indescribable. I mean, just give me a story and I'll get to it, man. Like, I'll jump on it. I really can't describe to you how much it's changed my life. You know, I've learned how to look up police records. I've learned how to really just be something that I never thought I would be in just 1 year. You know, I have another year to go here, and I'm really looking forward to it. Just want people to really know that when they read the paper, it's not just a paper. Every letter, every word means something.
Back in 2001, I think, right? Like 5 years ago, probably. 2001, 2002. But like I said, I'll make it brief. And like I said, 2011, yeah. So The Reporter basically became one student newspaper for the college back in 2010. So Monique was the first editor-in-chief. She came in as a high school student, which was daunting enough coming in. She thought she was going to be editor-in-chief of one paper, which is the Falcon Times, which was the North Campus paper at the time. And then she kind of got thrown into this whole hurricane of, we had about a month to put this together. Three separate staffs. But they were able to do it. So that's kind of, for me, why I'm very proud of this speaker series that's coming up, this year's series, not just Monique's, but the whole series, because all those kids were those kids that created what you see today, which is The Reporter. But Monique was the leader of that, kind of like the point guard of the team, I should say. And she had to deal with a lot of tough personalities, a lot of, not just outside of the newspaper while she was doing her stories, but the people that she dealt with in the staff. But like I said, she personified, I think, what we hope for a student journalist to be. So with that said, I'm going to let Monique speak. And
okay, now I'm really nervous. I just saw a video of myself. But I just want to say that I'm actually really excited to be here today. It was a huge chance that I wouldn't have made it today, actually, because of the shooting that you guys all know that happened in Orlando yesterday. There were, honestly, I had to fight to not go to be here with you. So I'm really excited about being here. As Manolo was talking, all these memories went through my head, so I'm a little emotional right now. The paper really did mean a lot to me. Honestly, it was because of the paper that I have succeeded in the way that I have, and honestly, it's almost like supernatural, because sometimes I can't believe it that, you know, I was able to go on these excursions to New England and Boston, to go to New York, back to Dallas, and I'm gonna tell you a little bit about that. But to begin, I did go to my interview in my prom makeup. That was crazy. That prom theme was actually an Oriental theme. And my dress was an Asian, you know, Oriental dress. And I went with chopsticks in my hair, I'll never forget it. And this updo and this crazy makeup and then a regular like business shirt. It was totally bizarre. But honestly, it was the best decision I ever made, because if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't have gotten the experience that I got at The Reporter. And I'm actually happy that it's a small crowd. I see so many familiar faces, and it really warms my heart, because I see professors here that were so lenient with me. Manolo mentioned that I was never in class. Don't do that. But it's true. I remember texting some of my professors saying, there's a breaking news thing, and I can't go, and please, here's a picture. And I would send them like a picture of like the crime scene or something. And back then I had a lot going on. I was actually at the Herald simultaneously and at the Reporter. So I was doing half and half. I would work an early morning shift at the Miami Herald as a breaking news reporter, and then that was like at 4 a.m. And then I would rush to campus to do the student newspaper. So, sounds crazy. I really don't know how I did it. My mom remembers me waking up. My mom is right here. I'm so happy that she's here. She remembers me waking up super, super early and like a zombie, Mom, I have to go, bye, peace. And I would go, and it all happened. And the issues always got put out. I really don't know how. And between arguing, right, Hector, right, Josue, arguing, fighting, laughing, crying, it was a mix of emotions. That's why I'm such a huge proponent for the student newspaper. I was talking with a couple of people who are currently in the paper, and you just have no idea what an opportunity you have at your hands. And I know not all of you want to be journalists, but I think that goes for every career. So, for example, I always knew I wanted to be a journalist, so joining the paper was kind of like a no-brainer. But I also met someone, you do advertisement, right, and marketing. You know, it's an awesome opportunity where he's getting experience doing marketing and all these ideas, and he was talking to me about some creative ideas that he, you know, came up with and put online, and it's going on social media, and I myself saw it. I was talking to a staff writer, you know, the editor, and I was talking to them, and it honestly built my character in such a way that I cannot describe. So I did cover a lot of hard-hitting stories here at The Reporter. It was insane to have someone close the door on my face. It was crazy to have people hanging up on me. It was, you know, I just had gotten into it. So having someone click the phone and be like, don't call me again, bye. And I'm like, why are they talking to me like that? I have to call back. No, I am not gonna let them hang up on me. So it really gave me the experience, and I promise you, I use it today. Politician hangs up on me, I'm like, what? I'm gonna call your house phone. I'm gonna call like the daycare where your kids go, and you cannot escape me. So it was honestly, it gave me a lot of experience, and I hope the politicians don't watch this video after. I'm looking in the crowd, I don't see anybody. Okay, that's good. So it was definitely something that gave me that experience. I mentioned in the video police records. I remember Manolo took me to pick up my first records. Where was it, in Broward? In Broward County. It was like a field trip for me. What? Police records? Yeah, let's go. So I went, and honestly, now I do it every day. I have to go through them to go pick them up. Sometimes they're online, sometimes they're not. So it was like the best experience that I got. And it all stuck, just to think that it was at a college, right? Many students think, oh, well, I'll never get there. Oh, I'll never be able to achieve whatever that dream is. You know, I've always told myself, even if you want to be someone, let's say, who picks up garbage, you pick up garbage the best way that you can. And honestly, it happened here that I got that kind of like that revelation. I remember I was walking on this campus far in the science building, and I was in a hurry to get to class, and it was kind of like a bad day. And there was this guy raking the leaves. And I was kind of like trying to get around him. I'm like, guy, I'm trying to get through. And he's like, ma'am, you have a good day. And he's like getting all the corners of the sidewalk. And I'm like, wow, you're doing a good job. He's like, hey, it's my job. I got to do it. And honestly, it was that moment. I was like, wow, that's incredible. He is raking leaves, but he's doing the best that he possibly can at raking those leaves. So, to me, that was an eye-opener, but I digress. At the paper, I covered crazy stories. I remember actually covering, he mentioned the basketball coach. That coach had verbally abused a student, and I remember that was a big deal. That was a story that I got pushback from college officials, you know, from the president, from the spokesman. He will hear this because he knows. I've talked to him about this afterward, but major pushback on not, you know, to write this story. And honestly, it was that pushback from me that made me see, okay, well, honestly, this story does need to be written. And it's not a small deal just because it's a college. If there's a coach, right, that's verbally abusing students, wouldn't you want to know? Right? The same way yesterday, the shooting happened. What did you do? You went online. You were searching hashtag Pulse, right? That's the name of the nightclub that it happened at. You were searching hashtag Orlando shooting or whatever it was, and there it was. So what if that reporter, right? Because we all know behind every byline, there's a person standing just like me, right? What if that reporter decided, oh, the police chief doesn't want to talk to me. Forget it. You would have never known that 20 people in the morning were shot dead. And then that death toll grew because those people that were in the hospital died. You would have never known that more than 50 people lost their lives yesterday, with 55 more in the hospital fighting for their lives. So it's a real thing. I speak about journalism like it's a lifestyle because it really is. When there's a hurricane, what do you do? What do you do? Huh?
Search it up.
Search it up, or some of you turn on the TV. My mom turns on the TV. She's like my weather lady. She tells me what the weather is all the time. But guess what? That meteorologist is also a journalist, right? You know, so it's really, for me, it's captivating. It's really a lifestyle. My family says that, you know, I'll be having dinner, and my family's like, this is not the newsroom. And I'm like, okay. Or they're like, you know, stop being a journalist. Pardon, she's being a journalist. And I'm like, it's kind of like my personality. I ask questions. But it was this paper that really got it started for that. While I was a student, not only did the reporter grow with me, which is so special and dear to my heart, but I grew as a person. I learned how to deal with people who said, I'll give it to you on this time, and then they didn't. I learned how to deal with people who were really rude to me, honestly, who were really nice to me. I had to deal with multitasking, with being on time, with speaking, which I'm obviously not that good at with a microphone. But I had to deal with all those things that really shaped who I am today. You know, when you get your job in real life, not everyone is as sweet as a cupcake, right? Does anyone work in here? Does anyone have a job? Does anyone ever mean to you sometimes? Yeah, it happens. It's real life. Not everyone's as sweet as can be. So that really molded me to handle it. Oh, I went through this. I can do this, right? So when I was at the paper, like I said, I was also at the Miami Herald. I remember covering the Trayvon Martin shooting. I actually wrote the first story on it. And this story is, you know, you can't forget it, because I remember at that time, I took on many different roles at the Herald. At one point, I was the early morning reporter. And depending on my classes, that would change. Then I became a night cops reporter for certain days of the week. And that's when it happened. I remember I was about to leave at 11 p.m. And then I got a phone call, actually from a student here at the college. And I think you might know him, Wabi. I forgot his name, I apologize. But a student called me, he's like, Monique. He knew I worked at the Herald and at the student newspaper. It was, honestly, he didn't have to call me, but he called me. He said, Monique, my nephew has been shot and he's dead and he's coming home in a body bag. I will never forget those words on the phone. I was leaving the newsroom. I was dying to leave. I was really tired, had a long day. And I remember immediately calling my editor, who was out at the time. I said, hey, you know, something happened in Sanford. They're like, it's Sanford. Why do we care? I was like, no. You know, he's from here, and the parents and this, and oh, but please, it needs a brief. We need to write at least something small in the paper. It needs to go in the paper. I started calling Sanford police, blah, 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 blah. Something short, quick, breaking. Got it in the paper the next day. I don't know how we put it in the paper. We have print deadlines. We got it in. Next day, it was media frenzy. Media frenzy. It became national news as the weeks went on. And I'll never forget, my editor at the time at the Herald said, if it wasn't, you know, for Monique, we would have never really had that story. Why, you know, and it was really interesting for me. That's something that I definitely grabbed from the reporter. That instinct to say no, like it needs to go in the paper. That came after me being hung up on, me being yelled at, you know, me writing stories that no one ever wanted to hear, you know, for it to go to print, and so on and so forth. And it was really awesome to be able to do that. I did stay on the story, and as it grew, many other reporters joined on with me. I got to work with Frenchie Robles, who is now at the New York Times. Mike Vasquez, I apologize, who's now at Politico, recently left. I was able to work with top-notch journalists at my age, and it was crazy. It was super bizarre. Anyhow, that's kind of like a taste of what I got at the reporter. And then that phone call came. So here I am, like, yes, I'm enjoying this. Oh my God, da, da, da. Then that phone call came saying I got a scholarship. What? I am not going to Boston. I am not going anywhere. You know, I had applied to UM. Even then, I was like, no, I'm staying. And then I threw a tantrum, right? It's like, no, I'm not leaving. And I had actually applied to the criminal justice. I didn't just look for information. I actually applied. So it was definitely an internal battle for me. I said, you know, I'm doing just fine. Why am I going to leave? I'm good here. This is like my turf, right? Like, you know, you build walls around you and you have this box, and I'm sure that that's for everybody here in your own life. Everyone has their own story. So I was like in my box and I was like, I'm good here. I'm doing great. I don't need this scholarship, because I had a scholarship here at Dave, so everything was paid for. I'm good. But then it was like that moment of truth where like you had to make a decision. I literally had like half a day to make a decision. And I remember being like the emotional person that I am. I started listening to songs. I was like, give me a sign. Give me a sign. I'm just gonna leave all my family. I mean, that doesn't matter. I'm just gonna move across the country with no one, with my Honda Accord that's like been faithful, but still. How am I gonna do that? No, I'm not doing it. So then I heard a song and I played it for my mother. Remember?
Yes, I do.
And I said, Mom, I have to go. I'm gonna have to go. I don't know what it is then. I have to go. I have to expand. So I'll save you the tears and all that stuff. I cried forever. I was so sad. Whatever. Everyone was happy for me at the reporter. But I was still kind of like somber about it. Anyhow, I did. I packed up my stuff and I left. And it was crazy. I went up to Boston and I'm like, why did I do this? I had a mattress. By the way, my scholarship even paid for my own apartment. That's how, what a big blessing it was. I had full tuition covered, my apartment, and I had gotten a full-time job at the Boston Herald. So everything was aligned for me. I had no reason to be crying, but I was. And I was like, I don't have furniture. Oh my God, what do I do? And I had this big mattress on the floor that I had just put on we had just put it on the roof of the car. And I just had that, I was like, what am I gonna do? This is crazy. I don't know why I'm here, whatever. I cried forever. I went to work that next day and I was, honestly, I got to cover really awesome stories there too. At first it was breaking news, and I covered breaking news, but then slowly but surely I started covering the courts in Boston. So here is this Miami girl, right, who was super uncomfortable with leaving, and now she's covering courts in Boston. I needed like a law book, because I had it's very different up there. Not only that, but the public records laws are very different. What is a public record? How do I say this? Public record is when, for example, your house got robbed and you fill out a report. That's public record. If I wanted to, I can go to the police station and be like, oh, what's your name?
Alex.
I want the police report for Alex's house that was burglarized yesterday. In Boston, they don't really have to give it to you. In Florida, they do. If not, it's against the law. So here I am, dealing with people who don't need to give me information and who don't need to call me back. Because here I had public records laws state that you need to answer this email in an orderly fashion. Over there it's different. You know, there are different rules, there are different parameters. It's crazy. I was dying. I was like, not only am I here in a strange land, now I have to deal with people who don't have to answer me. Like, what is going on? It was crazy. But I had to work through it. And honestly, I had to gather sources, you know, throughout the 2 years that I was in Boston. I had to start all over again. And it gave me that foundation to really be even a better reporter. So that's what happened. I spent a year full time at the Boston Herald. And then I got an internship at the Dallas Morning News. So here I am again. I'm in my bubble. I'm so good. Why am I gonna take an internship? I have a full-time job. They're not gonna hold my job when I come back. Who does that, right? If you say, Dina, oh, I'm just gonna go for the summer and leave and bye, and I'm just gonna go to Washington to like vacation or I don't know. They're not gonna hold your job. It's just crazy. They're not gonna do that. So I went up to my editor and I said, look, I don't know how to say this, but I have an internship and I have to go. Do you mind if I go? They're like, what is this internship? And I can't remember right now, but there was something happening in Dallas at the time. There was something important. I can't remember, I apologize. But it was something important and I was like, well, you know, all these things are going on in Dallas, and I was specific, and they knew because they're in the news industry. And I told them, hey, maybe they'll put me on that. They're like, you know what? This is gonna be good for you. You go, and you tell me when you're back. You're coming back, right?
Yes, coming back.
So, they let me go, and they held my job. It was crazy. They're like, don't worry, we're gonna have an intern, you know, two temps, just kind of like fill in that position and you'll come back. I was like, oh my gosh, that's insane. So Dallas honestly was one of the best internships I had ever done. I remember covering the public safety beat. It was amazing. I had great mentors there. It was honestly amazing. Again, I was covering courts. I'll never forget. And my grandfather's a big fan of this one story, but it was when a man threw a kitten off the second floor. And it was a huge story. All the animal activists were in the courtroom and they were there. And I was like, why do they care? I mean, it's a cat. Please don't be mad at me. I was just thinking about it in like the legal terms. It's a cat, like why is he facing 10 years in prison? And it was crazy. It was like a crazy sentence, 10 years in prison, and he had beat his wife and he had thrown the cat. And the cat's name was Kisses. And it was surreal. I was like, with my notepad, Kisses? Okay. And how did he throw the cat? Okay, but what color was the cat? And this lady's like crying because of her cat. She doesn't even care that the guy beat her up. It was the cat. It's like, okay, well, wrote that story. It was a long series of stories. You know, it just never ended. My grandfather's like, ¿y el gato? But what happened? Well, I'll tell you what. They gave him that sentence for 10 years. But it wasn't for hitting the wife because there was no proof of that. Unfortunately, in domestic cases, it got complicated. He did not get charged with that. It was just that animal cruelty charge, and he's in prison right now. So it exposed me to different things, and I was like, okay, well, move back to Boston. Here I am, right, my job. But then the Boston Globe offered me a part-time job, right? And I was like, okay, full-time job at the Herald or part-time job at Boston Globe? I was like, well, I already worked at the Herald, so I'm going to go with the Globe. And they were really upset, but it just happened, right? And I got there and I did good stuff. I worked late at night. It was, again, a different shift, but I was able to do it, all while going to Emerson, right? I'm sure my Emerson professors didn't see me much either. But they're not here, so it's fine. They didn't see me much. But it definitely was an amazing experience. I got to cover a lot of things with the Boston Globe. I was actually at the bombing that day. I was covering the marathon, and it was one of the scariest things I've ever encountered. I was interviewing runners as they passed the finish line, and I will never forget, I was interviewing this older man who was like in his 80s or something, and he was running for his grandkids. And to me, I was just, you know, interviewing this man. It's a real story. And then the bombs went off, and luckily I was far away enough, you know, from that. But that was another experience that I got. I was able to work with reporters. At that time, I was just assisting. You know, it was a team of like 20 people. But it was an amazing experience for me to be able to say that I was, you know, I was able to assist in that coverage. And it was really cool to be able to be there. It was really sad. By that time, I left Emerson and I got an internship at the New York Times. So here I am, my bubble keeps getting bigger, right? That little square at the reporter just started getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I was like, okay, well, I can do this. I moved to Dallas, and Dallas is really far from Boston. I can do New York. It's 4 hours away. I can do it. Honestly, it was one of the toughest internships I ever took part in. I was able to be exposed to, you know, people who went to work in suits. I don't go to work in suits. I dressed up for you, but at the Herald, you know, at any regular paper, you're a reporter, right? You're on the go. You need sneakers, you know, in your car. You know, you need jeans. You need some nice flowy pants that you can like duck if something happens, or I don't know. You need to be prepared. You need to do that. So I was like, suits? And then they would look at me from head to toe. I was like, okay, I need to buy a suit. My first day was like the worst wardrobe. Anyhow, I went, and it was every man for himself, every intern for themselves. And there was only three interns. I was like, oh, but I'm used to having someone tell me, go! Or like, at least giving me parameters. There it was like, no, you have a story idea? Okay, tell me. So here I am, wandering the streets of Manhattan, which was crazy for me. It was really insane being pushed on the subway, and I would get to work with like my hair all frizzy, and I was crying. By that time, my mascara was like down here, and I was like, why did I do that? Why did I choose to live in Queens? Why did I take that hour, you know, train ride? Why? I was so frustrated. But you know what? Honestly, it made me. I was able to deal with all that, and I promise you, all these experiences that I'm talking to you about started at the paper. You know, being in those uncomfortable situations, having to confront people that don't necessarily want to talk to you, you know, having to wander alone, you know, for stories that you might not know. I didn't know New York, I just moved there. So how am I supposed to come up with story ideas? So I'm like, okay. So I started walking down the street. By the way, you need to be safe when you're walking down these streets, and I'm a young lady. So I'm like, I need to figure this out. So I wrote really good stories there as well. I wrote some really nice profile pieces. At that paper, I was able to develop my creative writing skills. I got great training. It was great. So then reality hits. I'm done with college. I graduate from Emerson. Notice I didn't really talk about Emerson because I was always up. It was a great experience, and then the Herald offered me a job. And here I am in New York. Well, I was actually back in Boston in my apartment. And I'm like, okay, well, what do I do? Do I stay? Should I go? I don't know. That's a song, right? Should I stay? Should I go? And I was like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to go back home. So I came back down with for my family. It was the best ride of my life. I came back down, and now I'm at the Miami Herald. So here I am. My editors are like, you know, they're so happy for me because I'm back. So here I am covering government. I'm covering a series of different stories. Manolo mentioned just a few about this crocodile. Of course, we're back in Florida, right? Can I touch this? Oh, it's up, right? I wanted to put up a picture. Media? No, I can't do it. This crocodile. So I get to Miami and, well, I take that back. My first story is that Ray Allen's house got burglarized. So I was there in HR filling out all my like insurance paperwork and all this stuff. And my editor runs into HR. Monique, your beat is Coral Gables? Out. Ray Allen's house just got burglarized and you need to come up with something. I was like, I just got back. I barely even remember my way around. The highways are built now. The Palmetto's done. All these things. I'm like, I need a GPS. How do I get there? I didn't even remember a thing. I was like, because I was so used to riding the subway and then using my GPS and just moving across the country. It did something to my brain. I'm still trying to figure out this whole highway thing. So I was like, okay. So it took me a while to get there. My editor's calling. It's like, where are you? I promise I am almost there. So I got there. You know, and I got the best interviews. It was amazing. The coverage was great. I'll show you in a second. But it was a great, it was like, yes, I'm back home. It was like, what a welcoming, right? I didn't get my HR paperwork done until the next week, by the way. Because it was like a series of Ray Allen, Ray Allen, Ray Allen. It was going viral on Twitter and Facebook and all that stuff. After that, they intertwined. They're like, a crocodile. Was it a crocodile? A crocodile just bit a swimmer because they jumped in the lake late at night. And I was like, there's something wrong with that. Like, why are you jumping in the lake at 2 a.m? I was like, this is a cool story. I'm going to go after it. And I promise you, it all started with just a simple, like, crocodile bites man. And then people named this crocodile. His name was Pancho. And it went viral. I think I wrote more stories about Pancho than I did about Ray Allen. And I was like, this is not happening. They even had a funeral for Pancho. And they dispersed his ashes into the sea. And I was like, okay, this is cool. I'm back home. This is really cool. So I am not kidding. There is a funeral. Let me see if I can just find, so you know I'm not lying. I promise. Hold on. Pancho, Monique, Madden, and
Crocodile Tears.
There was a wake. It was a wake. So, honestly, it was a lot of fun.
Oh, that's Miami for you.
Huh?
That's Miami for you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We're back home, huh? So, hold on. Did I do something? By the way, are you guys subscribers of the Miami Herald?
Yes.
Ah! I see one paper. Seriously, you should at least get the online subscription. It's super cheap, and you'll be supporting the Herald. They didn't pay me to say that, I promise. Okay. I'm just going to read the first two graphs just so that you know how much fun I had. In honor of Pancho, the 12-foot, 300-pound American crocodile who died after being captured in Coral Gables in August, dozens of mourners stood on a Crandon Park beach and tossed some ashes into the wind and waters. But they weren't Pancho's ashes. And then it turns into like this environmental story about, you know, activists trying to raise awareness about animals and about nature and about not jumping into lakes at 2 a.m. Just, you know, like, it was really cool. And just to show you, I'm sorry, camera, the first thing you told me was to not come here, but, amen. They even did paintings for him, portraits of Pancho. You've seen this for yourself. I'm not making this up. Look at this man. Look at this woman with tissues. Ashes. He was, I mean, it was so sad. Oh, there I am. Look at me in the corner typing. You see me? That's me. I'm like, okay, well, I think that, I remember that moment. I was looking over to my right, the two people, the couple crying. I was writing it down. But that's one cool story I got to write. That's a fun, right? A fun story. Everyone can relate to loving Pancho. I'm almost done, I promise. Am I boring you? You look a little bored. I'm just kidding. Pancho happened, and then I was covering Coral Gables for a little while, and I was able to write really cool stories about the dysfunction in the police department. That's definitely a story that no one wanted me to write. It was tough. It was tough to be put in that circumstance where, you know, police officers are saying, you're not writing the story. And for me to say, well, yes, I am. I'm sorry, but I'm going to write it. And you can look up those stories later. Just type in dysfunction, Monique Madden, Herald, whatever, Four Gables. You'll find a whole bunch of stuff. All I write about is dysfunction. It's my specialty. But most recently, I just want to talk to you about the range of stories that I get to write. These are more of the stories that you need to find on your own. And it was about the city of Homestead. Anyone know where Homestead is? It's not too far. It's a huge drive. Sometimes I feel like just taking off to Key West instead. Bye, Homestead. Going to Keys. But in Homestead, there's a government. You guys know how that works. You know, you have City of Miami, Hialeah, different municipalities. Homestead's municipality is far, far away. And for a long time, they didn't have a Herald reporter there. They had an intern, maybe a freelancer. They didn't have anyone. So they're used to, what do you do when mom and dad's not looking? What do? Whatever you want. I'm gonna go run in the dirt. Mom and dad's not home, they're on vacation. And you go and you roll around in the mud. Well, that's kind of like what they were doing. we don't have a reporter, we don't have the limelight, we don't have a TV station. We're just so far away for them to drive here, so let's just do whatever we want, right? So sweet. Then I get there. I'm like, hi. How are you? And I promise you, they were so thrown aback. First of all, they totally like underestimated me because I'm young. And I get that. I'm young. So they think I'm an intern. Or they think I am shadowing. Oh, where's the real reporter? By the way, you mentioned Shaq. I interviewed Shaq. Really quick sidetrack. I love you, Shaq. But I walked in and they gave me a one-on-one interview with him, the police chief of the city of Doral. He said, look, I'm not giving this to anybody, but you have one-on-one with Shaq. Like, I got this. I walk in. I'm like, hi, Shaq. I took a picture next my foot, my shoe, next to his shoe. Oh, my God. Anyhow, I said, hi, Shaq, how are you? He's like, where's the reporter? I was like, I'm the reporter. No, I'm serious. Where's that? Your high school student? What? I promise you, he said. I was like, okay, well. Thank God he wasn't in trouble. It was a fun story about him joining the police department. But that's kind of like the feedback that I get sometimes. Oh, she's young. She's not really going to do anything. You know, it's fine. We can talk to her. She's not going to. So anyhow, that's something that I wrestle with every day. But to get back to Homestead, I introduced myself. They're super nice to me. By the way, I love the city of Homestead. I'm just pointing out a one story. Nothing bad about Homestead. They have a great community. However, I did notice that they had a city vehicle. What's a city vehicle? A car that's paid for by city government, meaning taxpayers like you or your parents who own homes. Let's say you guys all live in Homestead and you have a home. You pay taxes on that home, right? Those tax dollars are going toward that city vehicle, toward police services, toward garbage, toward, you know, the streets, all that stuff. Okay, but for some reason, that money's also going to this car. I'm like, cool. I'm like, but the car's never there. Where's the car? And it's like this big Tahoe. You know what a Chevy Tahoe is? It's a big car. I'm like, where's this car? So turns out the council members, the government officials, use those cars. And that car, it's a single car, whenever they want. And I'm like, cool, this is really cool. I wish the reporter had a car. I mean, I would have taken it everywhere. That's really cool. And I mean, it took me months to really hone in on it. But I realized that these same city officials that are using this car also get almost $1,000 a month from the government to pay for any transportation that they need. Let's say, you know, networking. You guys know what networking is? I'm sure you've had events. You guys have events, networking events, and you need to go. NHJ, NABJ, whatever. Let's say they were local. You go and use the car. That's understandable. But they have $1,000 in their pocket for that. But then there's this car. So what did I notice? That there was one councilman that was always using this car. It was never there. So I was like, what's the point of having the car if you get $1,000 to drive your own car for your own gas? And I'm like, So then this car gets free gas. You can crash it. They pay for it. Anything. Just think about a free car, not having to pay gas. Okay, where do you go for fun? Yeah. The mall? What if I told you I had a Chevy Tahoe for you every time you wanted to go to the mall? That's what's up, right? You get to go to the mall and just ride, wine and dine, right? Okay. So that's what was happening. This council member always had the car up. So then I got curious. I was like, what does he do with this car? What does he do? Where does he go? Okay. So I started digging around. You know, I made phone calls. I asked for public records. I said, I want all the SunPass records you have for that city vehicle. And I want to know where it's going. And of course, the entire city goes into a frenzy. They're like, what? And they start delaying me. And I'm like, I wrote SunPass records for the last 2 years for that car. That's what I want to know. So I got pushback from the city clerk saying that that takes time. They sent me a bill for almost $800 for that public record. And I said, no, 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 no. because usually when you ask for public records, they can charge you depending on staff time, and that's understandable. So if you work for the government and I'm asking you to come up with a list of all this stuff and that list doesn't exist, that means that you need to spend hours compiling that list, right? So I need to pay you for that labor. In this case, what do you do when you want some past records? Online, right? You press print. So I said, what are you doing? What labor? You press print. I'll press print if you want me to. Like, I'll press print. And they were like, no, is that we need to redact. I'm like, there is no private information on a SunPass record. It's all the transponder number. You guys know what I'm talking about? I'm not talking Chinese. It's all there. And I said, but what's the redaction? There's no private information there. So immediately when I said, you know, if you want to speak with our attorneys, here's, and I CC'd our attorney. Promise you, the next day I had all the SunPass records. It worked. So now I'm stuck with all these SunPass records, and they're actually really hard to decipher. They're really hard to comb through. It's all these numbers and all these streets, and remember, I need GPS? Remember that? What highway? Okeechobee? Where is Okeechobee? I had no idea. There's like many exits. I had to look up a map. It took me months. So then, you can read the story. I put it all together, and I realized that he was going golfing with that car. Yeah, I kind of chuckled too. Okay. He was going golfing. And I'm like, golfing is expensive. He was paying for the golfing. But that's something else. I'm like, okay, he's going golfing. I started tracking the car, going, you know, playing like spy, almost. I followed him at one point. It was like a big mess. There was one time where I followed him, and this is probably every reader's favorite part of the story. If you've read it, you'll notice that I described that a reporter follows him through the streets for a couple miles, and I call him. I see him pull him to a Taco Bell, like through the drive-thru. And here I am, like, okay, well, I'm gonna call him now. I know he's free. He's at Taco Bell, right? He's free. He's not in a meeting, right? He's gonna answer me. I wanna talk to him about him golfing in this car. And I call him and he picks up. It's actually really nice. He's a really nice guy. And I'm like, hey, councilman, how are you? He's like, I'm good. How about you, Monique? It's a matter of time you were gonna call me. And I'm like, what do you think I'm going to talk to you about? I've seen all the records requests, but I just want to let you know that, you know, there's nothing wrong there. And I'm like, but you don't even know what I'm going to ask you. He's like, no, but wait a minute. I have another call. I'm in a meeting. I have another call for someone's calling me for some business thing. I was like, okay. And I'm looking at him, and he puts his phone on mute, and he places his order at Taco Bell. And I'm like, oh my lord, this is like a movie, right? And I'm like, oh, this is not happening. Places his order at Taco Bell, takes me off mute. Yes, Monique, I'm sorry, I'm in the middle of this, you know, thing and IT thing and this whole thing. And I was like, okay, well, when can you talk? And at that point, I'm not gonna tell him that I'm watching him because maybe I'm charged with a crime or something like that. I didn't wanna do that. I figured that, you know, you pick your battles, right? You know, I'm not, what am I going to do, make him talk to me? I'm looking at him, he's eating a taco. Like, he's driving and eating a taco, you know, you drive and you eat. I was like, what, well, at that point, you know, I'm just going to leave it alone. He said, we'll talk later. I said, okay. He didn't call me back. It's a week of this. He always answered my calls. I can't talk right now, that I'm so busy and I have this to do, that to do. And I was like, but we need to talk. I need to talk to you. And as soon as I would like launch my question, gotta go back. I was like the nicest person to deal with that would hang up on me. It was super weird. Never said anything mean to me. Came the time that I said, look, I'm writing this story whether you like it or not. These are my questions. It looks like you receive $1,000 for this car. And you also are using this car for personal business, which you're not allowed to. you know, just like police officers can't go to name a place.
Starbucks.
You can't. Well, it's different for them because they, if they're on their way home or something, they're able to stop. But you can't go to a party in your police car. You can't go to a soccer game in your police car. You can't do those recreational things. So it's a little different. But it's the same thing, like you're using it for personal use. So I asked him all those questions and he never responded to my emails. Fun fact about it, he had all of his logins for golf online. And he logged all his, you know, just like an app where you can log all your running and stuff. And sometimes you have the option of putting it public or private. You know, honestly, I did that once. I'm a runner, so I put in, when I found out that his golf stuff was online, I was like, wait a minute. I have a running thing. I Googled my name in the running app thing, and I saw my activity. It showed all my routes. I was like, delete. Oh my God, delete. I can't believe people can see where I'm running. I didn't know. I mean, that's a safety hazard. But anyways, it was kind of like that, where it was public. And that's what happened. I asked him all the questions. He didn't respond. My editor contacted him, our attorneys, nothing. The story went out, and it was pure silence. And I didn't get a single call from anybody. Long story short, sometimes you feel, right, that you put so much effort into exposing truth, right? Or, I don't know, maybe you guys are nursing students or another area. You know, you feel like you put so much effort and then you see no fruit, right? You see nothing come from it. And at first, for a week, I was like, no one has called me. You know, and that's how the world works sometimes, you know, and I know that as a reporter, I did the right thing in putting out that story, because with your tax dollars, someone's going golfing. It's not fair. It sounds like a small crime, but then it grows, right? It grows into small corruption scandals, maybe money laundering, you know, so it grows. So I felt as, you know, the person covering that community that community needed to know. So within a week, I received so much feedback from the actual residents. I heard nothing from the government, but I heard so much feedback from the residents. And I said, you know what, my job actually does matter. It matters because people care. You know, you would want to know if they were using your money to, I don't know, throw parties, a New Year's party, right? You would want to know. So that was kind of my experience most recently. To end my long, long speech on a happy note, I recently wrote a really cool story about Cafecito, who likes coffee. Did you guys know, did you see it go viral online about Pinecrest Bakery and the whole Starbucks thing that you remember? Well, I was able to write that story, right? And I said, you know what? I want to be there when you give out the first cafecito. And I was able to go. And I was able to be there and tell that story about, you know, this fight with Starbucks and this small business and Starbucks trying to push them out. It's really interesting. So I just wanted to show you a couple of pictures just to show you about, you know, the array of stories that I get to write. But this was really recent, like 2 weeks ago, 1 week ago. Hold on. And for me, it's not really just about, you know, oh, it's a story, blah, 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 people like coffee. For me, it was being able to, honestly, when I was there, seeing people sip their coffee, I would see people come in and be like, oh, ¿tienes café? They'd be like, no, we don't have it yet, I'm sorry. People would be so upset because they didn't have their coffee, you know, in a Cuban bakery. And I was like, wow, this is really important, a story about coffee. And we actually did a video. I worked with videographer Emily Michaud on this, and it was really cool to be there as they set up the machine. But I love this commercial. I think I know the words already. She's talking about picking up glass and Zephyr Hill, you see? Is it on?
Yes.
It's on?
Yes.
I'm sorry. But sometimes you don't realize it, but there are stories in your community that there's someone writing them, right? I don't know, Hector, tell me a story that means a lot to you. Random, sports probably, right? There's a sports journalist back there that goes to these games and writes these stories. And then you get to read them. To me, I don't know, it's almost magical. It's like, wow,
so cool.
Get to tell stories for a living. I get to call people and harass them. Yesterday I was at dinner with some friends and I started asking them questions. One girl is training to be a firefighter and I was just asking her questions. Like 30 minutes in, she's like, "Are you interviewing me?" And I'm like, I didn't even notice. But I guess it was so interesting to see that. Yeah?
Today is an exciting day. Today is an exciting day. We're actually installing our new coffee machine to make our cafecito, cafe con leche. We had gotten an order that we had to remove the machine and actually take down the menu for our coffee. Pretty much there was a kind of misunderstanding in regards to the availability for us to sell coffee. When this went to social media on our Facebook, the community just stepped in, stepped out. They were super passionate about the fact that we couldn't sell our cafecito, and basically our tradition had been tampered with. With those voices, we were able to take this to the next step. And so we came together with the landlord yesterday, and very amicably, we reached a conclusion that we can sell our coffee, and business as usual. Cuban coffee to us is as important as drinking water. You know, it's part of our DNA, it's part of our genetics, it's what we grew up with. And the fact that when you come in here, you step into our place, you eat your pastelito with a cafecito, it's a perfect combination. And when you don't have one with the other, then you lose out on it. And we're very blessed that we have it back and we're here to serve.
It was gone for such a long time, so we really wanted it back and we waited for it. So yeah,
it was worth the wait.
It was definitely worth the wait.
It's a good place to be today. It's a good day.
Well, ain't wrong.
So that was really cool. Anyhow, that cafecito story mattered to somebody. When I was walking in, people were like, coffee's back, and they were so excited to drink it. I was like, this is a story worth telling, right? Even if it's small. So you have your big stories, you have your small stories, but yeah. I would like to answer any questions that you may have, and that was about my time at the reporter / everywhere else in the country, so it was fun. Any questions?
Ronald Fulton.
We have two microphones here.
Ronald Fulton,
that is his name, yes. Is he still here?
No, but I'll communicate with him sometime.
Robert, take care of. Yes, it was Mr. Fulton. Yes, thank you. Any questions? The mic? You cannot leave me like this. I will not take it.
The homestead story didn't lead to any firings or anything?
No, it didn't. Actually, this Wednesday, there's a council meeting, which I will be at. It would be my first time kind of being there in person. I'm hoping they'll still say hello to me. But we just never know. I've written stories in the past in Homestead that have made no change. And I think it's just a culture there, a government, a political culture that they're so far away on the radar that they don't need it. I've had my stories, the ethics, the Dade County Ethics Commission had investigated on it, and then that's all, as far as it got, nothing happened. So it happens. And it just, sometimes, depending on the community, nothing happens because it's a political circle. But, you know, you just got to stick in, you know, stay in there and just keep being persistent.
Well, the other thing is the citizens don't care, then, you know,
Yeah, it just depends on the community. I cover Doral, Pinecrest, Palmetto Bay, and Homestead, and they're all different.
Why Doral? It's so far from the other.
Yeah, actually I fought for that city. When I first got to the Herald, I was covering Coral Gables and Doral. Then I switched beats from Coral Gables, and I started covering, no, I'm sorry. Then they switched my beat again, it's been changed like 5 times, to all the South cities, so Pinecrest, Palmetto Bay, all those things, and North Miami Beach. So that was like, why am I covering North Miami Beach? It was super strange. It was a readership issue. We're changing our dynamics on how we decide which cities to cover, and Doral just didn't have a readership audience in English. They have a lot of Venezuelans, so they're reading El Nuevo Herald. So they made the executive decision to say, you know what, El Nuevo Herald is going to cover Doral. And then it led to it not being covered much, as much as it should be.
Do you learn Spanish too?
No, but they get translated. So you'll see a lot of my stories translated.
Into the novela?
Yeah. Yes?
You know, Mo jokes about not going to class very often, but believe me, she was in my classes, 2 or 3, and if I could have given an A+, I would have given an A+. She's an excellent student. Mo, you mentioned about how students, you asked if any students are reading the newspaper, and of course you see not too many, if any. Perhaps they're reading it online, I hope so, but how do you get students interested in reading the newspaper, or is it a lost cause?
That's a very good question. I can address that in terms of the Miami Herald as well as the student newspaper. We were just talking about that on our way in. How do you get students to say, I need to read the reporter? Or how do you get the general population in Miami-Dade County to say, I need to go online and check the Herald? It's really hard. Unfortunately, the grounds are shifting and people are only reading online. I don't want to say it's a lost cause because that would break my heart and I would faint. But I think that there are ways to get that to happen. It's just going to take a lot of innovative thinking and a lot of creativity to see, well, okay, what makes you go online? You know, a lot of us get our news off Facebook. I mean, I get my news off Facebook sometimes. People cringe at that idea, but it's the truth. You get it off Twitter. How can you translate? How can you gather enough people to say, the reporter knows what drama shows there are? You know, this month, I'm going to go there to check. You know, I think it also relies heavily on the staff as well to say, you know what, people really care about the drama shows or about, I don't know, the dance club. We need to cover it more. So it's really, it's a shifting ground. It's a shifting landscape to say, okay, well, today it may be drama, but tomorrow may be basketball. What are we doing to catch up? And I think that that's the biggest challenge. When I was here, a lot of students, you know, didn't read the newspaper, but it was about pushing it, and they do a great job at putting it on the stacks and stuff like that, and they're all over the internet. My friend here created a meme, right? I love that meme. He's getting with the program. He's like, okay, well, people like memes. I'm going to do a reporter meme, right? That's what he said. So he's doing it, and I think slowly but surely, I think it takes a lot of commitment for the newspaper. I think it's challenging because there's a high turnover rate every year or two. People come and go. How do you deal with a staff that's ever changing? So it's just about commitment and just having that. You know, it starts with the staff. It really does. And then hope you guys read the paper. Please read the paper.
Have anybody ever told you not to pursue a story?
Absolutely. Are you talking about my editors or my readers?
Both, I guess.
Okay. There are two different types of situations. There have been times where I think that something is an amazing story, and I pitch it, and my editor, depending on who it is, will say, not right now. We're not doing that. Or some will say, yeah, do it. You know, or sometimes I just do it. But I've been told in the past, no, Monique, that's not a story, or we can change it like this, or I get it all the time, where I get pushback from people, like I said, hanging up on me, telling me, don't write this story or else. I've been threatened before. It's hard, you know? You have to make that decision, and is it worth running? Is it not? I always like to take advice from my colleagues. When I know that a story needs to be written, I always go to colleagues that I trust and I say, look, this is what I have in my hand. What do you think? And 9 times out of 10, they say, go. That's important enough to go. So you do it. There are tons of stories out there that you see on CNN and all these stations, wherever you get your news from, that reporter got a lot of negative reactions from. But they still pursued it and said, I'm not going to stop. And you know what? Sometimes it takes time. There are stories that sometimes the first time around, I can't get it in time, you know? And it's a project that you end up working on for like 5 months. This golf story took me 5 months. It took a long time. And then, you know, but I did it. You know, so it's more of like an internal thing where you say, you know what, this is worth it. Or you can say, you know what, I'm just going to cover the carnival down the street. I'm going to go write about this fun event. You know, so it's definitely up to your discretion. But did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Sure. Okay, sorry. Anyone else?
Good afternoon, Monique. My name is Rafael Trujillo. I just graduated and I'll be pursuing a journalism major at Emerson College. So my question is, time management. Your life seems to be crazy since the early ages. And in a 24-hour day, you do so much. How do you do it? That's a big question. How did you accomplish to do all of that? Because sometimes it's insane. I understand you were an honors college graduate as well. So you didn't show up to class, you know how difficult it is in the last college. You were working at the Herald, you had that reporter, you have your personal life.
Yeah.
And then moving to Boston, New York, Dallas. How was it? How did you do it?
Good question. I'm so glad he asked this. Time management, imperative, vital. What got me through all of that was balance. That word almost sounds impossible with everything that you heard. But Manolo can attest, I did marching band when I was part of all of this. I did color guard, and I threw flags and rifles, and it was so much fun. People tease me at the Herald right now, because I love it so much. And I did marching band, and it was, and I made it a thing that I needed to do it. It was something that released my stress, that it was there for me, and it was important to me. Another thing that I do, and this is, I don't do marching band anymore, but, you know, I teach Bible study on Wednesdays, and it's every Wednesday. That is my day. You know, yes, news happens, but guess what? My Bible study changes to Thursdays, or something happens on Thursday, I have to have it, because that is my commitment. That's my personal, right? That's my personal life. And if you're not feeding yourself, if, you know, and I go to the gym, sounds crazy. How do you do all that stuff at once, or how do you do it? But it's really about time management and saying, okay, well, what is it that's important to me aside from career? Because if there's one thing that I learned in all of this is that your career does not define you, right? I can say that I'm a journalist, and that is true, but it does not define me. My name is Monique. And there's 1,000 other things that you do not know about me, right? That have nothing to do with journalism. You know, I like to eat. I mean, everyone likes to eat, but I like to try new things. You know, I enjoy going on a long run. There are many things that are important to me. I serve at my church. That's important to me. And that's something that I won't stop doing in the name of journalism. And I'm so lucky and blessed that the staff at the Herald agrees with me. And they say, you do you. Because at the end, you will be burnt if you don't do you. Oh my God, there are people in the Herald that have weird hobbies. You think weird. I mean, they like do the sailboat racing. I didn't even know that was a thing. I have a colleague, I'm totally putting him on blast, who races sailboats. And I'm like, that's a thing? Yes, I need to relax somehow. And that's what he does. He races sailboats. And I'm like, okay, well, that is important. You have to do you. You have to take a day for you. You know, every day I wake up and guess what? I like to eat breakfast.
and I make my breakfast, and I don't care what's waiting for me. I make the breakfast that I want the way I want it, because that's something that I enjoy. So, and I take a run every day, or I'll, you know, do Pilates or something that is what I enjoy. But yes, time management, super important. Always make sure that you're not losing yourself in it, because at the end of the day, something happens, right? And what I've learned is that journalism is not gonna be there to hug me when I need it. It's gonna be the people around me, like my parents, like my husband, like my friends, like everyone. They're the ones that are gonna be there for you. So I just wanna encourage you to never lose sight of who you are in all of this. It's all about, yes, your career is, it does define you, but it doesn't define you. Does that make any sense, Professor? Yeah? No? No sense? I'm just talking. I'm sorry. Well,
thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else?
A lot of the times you mentioned that you have to have like a no-nonsense, persistent attitude to be a journalist, which is obviously a very critical part of being a journalist. But there's a lot of journalists that are probably the opposite, where they're timid or they're shy. They're afraid to push the envelope, get into controversy with the people. What advice would you give to those people that are really afraid to push the envelope and are afraid to, be persistent?
Wow, another great question. I think fear has a lot to do with it. And sometimes we're scared to confront people. I'm sure in your personal life, the last thing you want to do is confront somebody. Sometimes you're not just, I'm definitely that type of person, but there are people who are not. You know, my sister's not like that. My sister is very opposite of me. And I think the one thing that I would give to advice to journalists would be to really, I don't want to say ask for help, but sometimes you just need someone who does have that, and maybe you just need a good pep talk, right? We have reporters now in the newsroom and the Herald that might not be that type of person that's like, okay, let me have them. They're a little bit more reserved and different at how they do stuff, but I don't want to say that you have to be like that. I don't want to say that every single journalist that is successful has to have that personality. That's just a personality thing. If you have your head aligned to the mission of what you have, which is, I'm going to tell the truth, no matter how hard it is to do it, I think you're going to be okay. And I think it's just reminding yourself that how important it is. And it has to be important to you to expose truth, to bring light into darkness, right? You have to. That is definitely something that every journalist has to have. But the rest is just a personality thing. You know, some people approach situations in a different way, and I don't want that to discourage you. Sometimes it's fear. It takes time, right? You know, I'm not going to say that it was easy for me to confront or to argue or to be persistent. Sometimes it's scary, you know, and I've had, even at the college as a student journalist, it all started here. It was fear. It was almost as if they were instilling fear into me. And it was that moment where you just have to like, okay, well, I'm going to do it this way, and I'm going to talk calmly, and I'm going to say, look, you know, you don't have to yell. You can just talk normally, however you are. And I'm more than positive that it's going to be fine. But it's about your heart. It's about saying, okay, well, my mission is clear. I believe in telling stories, no matter the repercussions. That you have to have. But other than that, it's all personality things. It's, you know what I mean? I hope I answered your question. Anyone else? Yes, no, maybe so? No? You don't have a question for me?
What are you covering right now? What's your study? What's your case right now?
Oh, I cover government. So I cover community stories. I cover government. It's not as boring as people think. I never thought that I would go into covering government. But it's honestly the heart of what runs your life. Politicians run your life. Just letting you know. Newsflash.
and it all starts locally, and that's what I cover. So I cover, my routine day is basically, if there are any council meetings, I go to those council meetings. If there aren't, I spend time on the phone at the office, making calls, trying to figure out, okay, well, what's going on in this city? And trust me, it keeps me busy since I have so many. So doing that. Or sometimes, like last Friday, I spent the day in Palmetto Bay, driving around, knocking on doors, you know, for a story I'm working on, hanging out at the local coffee shop. I do that a lot. You know, trying to meet people, trying to see, okay, well, what's in your community that I haven't covered? Because I don't live there. You know, I don't know what's going on here. Is there something going on that I don't know about that I have not reported on? That's basically the essence of my entire day, is trying to find stories and then bringing them to life. Other times it's kind of like straight. You just know, oh, there's a meeting. I'm going to cover that meeting. But this Cafecito story wasn't like that. It was kind of like something that just happened. It was off the agenda. It's not, that's not a government story. That's more of a community story. So yeah, and I encourage you guys at The Reporter, find out what people want to read. Yeah. Find out, because maybe you don't even know what they want to read about. So just never know. Yeah. Anyone else?
I got a question, Marie.
Yes.
When we cover stories, sometimes if you have to write a story or something that happens, you know the person, you know it's going to hurt them. It's going to be embarrassing maybe for them. You kind of don't want to have to write it, or you don't want to report it, but you have to. Like, I think you were talking about, the basketball coach here?
Yeah.
What I dealt with that, remember? At some point we became friends. Not friends, but we got better,
Sure. We
got better. And then that happened, and he was kind of, I think at one point he texted me, hey, why are you guys writing this story? It's something we have to do. So how difficult is it for you, like the golf story? I'm sure it's, when you know that story is going to really be embarrassing, you know, people have families and things like that, reputations online, etc. So how difficult is it as a reporter is it for you to know you have to write this and this will, you know?
That's a very good question. And you mentioned the golf story, and that's definitely a story that I struggled with that. This guy's a really nice guy, and I say that on the record. Actually really nice. He's a family, and you know, other council members, you know, they're widows maybe, or they have kids that they need to support. They need to put a roof over their head. How do you make that decision? And for me, it's a lot of reflection, my friend. It was a lot about, okay, well, I'm so a human being. You know, I'm a journalist, but I'm also a human being. And it makes you think, okay, well, can I separate my emotions from this? Is this a story that needs to be told, or am I just picking on somebody? There's a difference. Are you just picking at somebody that really, not really a story? You're just going after it? I mean, it depends. You have to weigh it out. And for me, that's one of the toughest challenges that I face. You know, in another city that I covered just last week, you know, he was a good source of mine and good person. All of a sudden, he's being investigated by authorities, right? And the story is like not this small, it's like that big. So as a person who has shared with this person, who has gotten to know, right, their family history, daughter's names, you know, maybe wife's name, I've seen them around. How do you write that story? And for me, it is what it is. I have to write it. It's my job. And after I write it, because remember, there is disclosure. They know that I'm a journalist. They know that I'm a reporter. So it gets down to that. And it's a really tough call, but you have to, I guess you just have to know. And I don't want to say follow your heart, because it's not like that. It really isn't. It's not. It's hard. But you have to make the call. Like, that was an important story for me to write, and I believed that as nice as you are, this is a story that needs to be told. It's kind of like if your best friend murders somebody. I'm being serious. Can you imagine that happens? What do you do? Do you call the police? It's your best friend. You do it? I don't know. Is it the right thing to do? That person just killed somebody. Oftentimes it happens with parents. The kid does something, kills somebody, the parent calls the police on their own child. What do you do? It's just a thing. You have to just know what is the right thing. And it's not easy.
On behalf of the reporter, we want to give you this token of our appreciation. And thank you for coming today.
Thank you. Devoted service. This is so nice. Thank you, Manolo. Thank you guys so much. Soldiers, you stayed the whole way.
We'll have another event for our next speaker series. We don't have the date yet, but it'll be the end of June now. Yeah, end of June. We'll be announcing it soon, so we're hoping to that you guys will be able to come. It'll be out.
Yeah, you should really go. She's awesome. If you thought I was great, she's awesome. She's great. I hope you thought I was great. She's really great.